Hello, my name is Mr. Bob Swanson. I'm one of the online instructors for astronomy, and I wanted to actually review a little bit. I'm going to try to make a series of tutorial videos that hopefully will help you step through these lab simulations, because we'll be using these for the rest of the semester, and some students have been having a hard time getting through these on their own. And so I wanted to, at least starting with Module 2, through the rest of the semester, I'll try to provide some little video tutorials to help you understand what these simulations are trying to teach. But before I can move into Module 2, I actually want to review real quick and make sure that you're very clear on the different coordinate systems used in astronomy. And this was essentially taught in the last module. If you remember, you had gone to this particular simulation. It was called Basic Coordinates and Seasons. And so I'm going to do this first video just as a review of some of the basic coordinate systems used in astronomy, because without these, without a firm knowledge of these, you're not going to be able to make much progress through the rest of the semester. These are very, very important. So, you know, why do we have coordinate systems? That's, you know, one of the first questions that is asked. You know, if, you know, here on Earth, in order to find any particular location and to pinpoint that location, you need to have two pieces of information. You need to know how far from the equator is that spot. So, for example, Fulton, Mississippi is about 34 degrees north of the equator. The equator is essentially the zero line of what's called latitude. And then Fulton is about 34 degrees north of that of the equator. And of course, since the equator is 0 degrees, and the poles then are at 90 degrees, the North Pole is 90 degrees north, the South Pole is 90 degrees south. And then that's what these lines then indicate, lines of equal latitude. So of course, knowing the latitude is not enough, because 34 north, you could be anywhere on that parallel. And so you need the longitude, the distance east or west of the prime meridian. That becomes the other important value. You can pinpoint the location on Earth if you know the distance north of the equator or south of the equator, that's your latitude, and if you know your distance east or west of the prime meridian. And it just so happens, now the prime meridian is a little more arbitrary as far as where it is chosen. It turns out it's this line right here, the line that goes from the North Pole to the South Pole and passes through Greenwich, England. That is considered to be 0 degrees longitude. And then you work your way either east or west of that line of longitude to determine your location. So that's what's happening if you wanted to pinpoint a spot anywhere on the Earth. Now, of course, astronomy, we're not dealing with things on the Earth, we're looking at things in the sky. And so, if I wanted to determine the location of a star, if I go out tonight and I look in the sky and I see a star or a planet in the sky, it would be sort of nice to be able to determine, okay, what's the location of that star? And there's a couple of different ways of figuring that out. There's two different systems, in fact. There's what's called the horizon system. And let's see if I've got it. It may actually be, this one is in your rotating sky. They've got the horizon system. And here we go. The horizon system is kind of Earth-centric. You know, it's you look out in the sky and you see a particular star. There's that star. And you want to pinpoint its location. Well, you can do it with respect to yourself, the observer. You can say, well, gosh, you know, when I look at that star, and I'm gonna view it from, you know, the viewer's perspective, notice there's the star in the sky. And I could say, well, gosh, how would I tell somebody else where that star is? Well, I could say how far above my horizon it is. So I could look out at my horizon and then kind of look upward and see how far I would have to look up in order to locate that star. And it turns out this star is about 45 degrees above the horizon. Well, where does 45 come from? If I'm looking flat out along the horizon, I call that 0 degrees. If I look straight up, I call that 90 degrees. And so it turns out that, yes, this star is about 45 degrees above the horizon. So hopefully you can envision that. One value is not enough, though, because notice that if I say that the star is 45 degrees above the horizon, someone can ask me, well, which horizon are you talking about? Because notice that a star anywhere along this line here, this circle, is 45 degrees above the horizon. It's a matter of which horizon am I referring to. So you need another piece of information. In this case, I have to specify which horizon. And the way we specify horizon in astronomy is we say, well, gosh, let's call due north, we're going to call that 0 degrees. And just, you know, so if I was talking about a star located at 45 degrees, I'll move my star over here. If the star happened to be 45 degrees above my northern horizon, then I would say, okay, it's 45 degrees above the northern horizon, and that's actually, in astronomy, that's called altitude. So the altitude is 45 degrees, and the azimuth, is what specifies which horizon I'm talking about. The azimuth happens to be 0 degrees, because it's due north. I know the number here shows 359.9. That's because the values go from 0 north all the way around to 360 when you get back to north. And again, the numbers go upward as you go eastward, or clockwise, around this little circle here. So therefore, getting back to my original star, if I move my star back to where it was originally, it was over here somewhere, it had an altitude of 45 degrees, and it was somewhere in this direction. And, well, what direction is that? Well, notice that, again, I start from north, being 0, east is 90, south is 180, west is 270. Again, I'm just going up in steps of 90. So sure enough, where my star was originally, it's somewhere between east and south. So it's somewhere between 90 and 180, and it turns out it's about 145 degrees. So I call it that southeast. And now, if I give that azimuth value as well as the altitude value, that gives me the precise location of this particular star. That's what's called the horizon system of coordinates. That's one way of specifying the location of a star in the sky. However, that system does have drawbacks, and I'm going to try to show you why in the next video that I present. But right now, I just wanted to show you how you determine altitude and azimuth. And again, that's based really on your observer. Your observer just looks out and says, well, gosh, I want to know where that star is or that planet is. How high above the horizon is it? That's my altitude. And which horizon am I talking about? That's my azimuth. That's that one system. Now let's go back into last week's simulation and learn more about what's called the equatorial system, or sometimes it's called the celestial sphere system. And this is actually very similar to, and is very similar to latitude and longitude, and that's why it was presented last week. So now we have what's called the celestial sphere. What we do is we pretend that all the stars in the sky are just little pinpricks on a big globe that's outside the Earth. Now, that's not the way it is in reality, but we can pretend that all the stars are located on this big sphere that seems to be rotating around the Earth. And that way, when you look up in the sky and you see a particular star, you can assign coordinates to it. But the coordinates in this case are not based on the observer on the Earth. They're actually fixed coordinates on the big old sphere. Just like on the Earth, the lines of latitude and longitude don't change because the Earth is rotating. You know, Fulton is always 34 degrees north and about 88 degrees west of the Prime Meridian. And that never changes despite where I'm located on the Earth or that the Earth is spinning. Those latitude and longitude values are fixed. Likewise, with this system, the celestial sphere system or the equatorial system, the lines that go along with the celestial sphere never change, despite the fact that the Earth is turning. And so if I want to specify the location of this particular star, I have to know, again, two pieces of information. In this case, I have to know how far north or south of the celestial equator that particular star is. And the celestial equator is just the Earth's equator projected outward onto the celestial sphere. So the celestial equator essentially divides the sky into a northern half and a southern half. And this particular star happens to be in the northern half. And so I say it is 40 degrees above the celestial equator. So that's very similar to latitude, but the astronomy term is declination. It has a declination of positive 40 degrees. If the star was below the celestial equator, I would say it's 32 degrees south of the celestial equator, or more commonly it says you would give it a declination of negative 32 degrees. But again, notice that just by giving the declination does not tell you the position of that star, because that star could be anywhere on this circle, on the celestial sphere. So I need a little more information. I need to know how far, kind of east or west, right? Well, in this case, you know, just like on the Earth, east and west is given by longitude. In astronomy and on the celestial sphere, the direction east or west is given by a term called right ascension. And this is just like longitude is kind of arbitrary. You know, the zero point is just chosen to be through Greenwich, England. Likewise, in astronomy, it seems like the zero point is somewhat arbitrary. But it turns out that, and I'm going to actually click on the labels here just to make these points a little more clear. Like I said, the equator on the Earth is similar to the celestial equator. You're just projecting the Earth's equator outward. Wanted to point out a couple of other things. The geographic North Pole, if you take that North Pole and project it outward, and where it intersects the celestial sphere, you have the North Celestial Pole. Likewise, in the Southern Hemisphere, where the geographic South Pole, if you extended that out into space and it punctured the celestial sphere, you would have your South Celestial Pole. Just wanted to make that clear. Now, as far as right ascension, getting back to that, where do you start? Well, it turns out that the zero point for right ascension is where the ecliptic, and this is a term that, again, I'm going to get into in the next video, the ecliptic, which is the path of the sun through the sky during the course of the year, it's where that intersects the celestial equator. Now, the sun does not just travel along the celestial equator during the course of a year, and that's because the Earth is tilted with respect to its orbital plane. So there is actually a point of intersection. The ecliptic, the path the sun takes through the course of the year, intersects the celestial equator in two spots. And those are called equinoxes. And again, I'm going to get to those in a future video. But there's two of them. There's two points of intersection, one of them being right here. And this is what's considered to be the zero hour of right ascension. It's also considered to be the vernal equinox. And so, in order to specify right ascension, you set your you figure out that this is the zero point, right here where it turns from green to blue. And then the right ascension is specified by going eastward from that vernal equinox. And it's given in hours. Because it takes 24 hours for the Earth to spin once on its axis, right ascension is measured in hours. So therefore, to specify the position of this particular star way over here, it turns out that it is, again, 36 degrees above the celestial equator, so positive 36 degrees declination, and its right ascension is 16.2 hours. And again, that's because it's pretty far around from this, what's called the vernal equinox. Halfway around, somewhere around here, is 12 hours. So therefore, yes, this is about 16.2 hours. Once I've specified those two coordinates, I can then pinpoint the star. Now, we'll kind of compare and contrast those two systems in the next video.